Hey gang, thanks for joining me again. I'm Movie Man Gary. Today I'm going to take a trip down memory lane to revisit the golden age of romantic comedy. If you're a romance aficionado, then hang out with me as I count down my top 10 best romantic comedies of the classic era. So grab your popcorn and let's dive in. Coming in at number 10, The Lady Eve.
He's returning to his book. He's deeply immersed in it. He sees no one except... Watch his head turn when that kid goes by.
Won't do you any good, dear. He's a bookworm, but swing him anyway.
Oh, now how about this one?
How would you like that hanging on your Christmas tree?
Oh, you wouldn't?
Well, what is your weakness, brother? Holy smoke, the drop kerchief. That hasn't been used since Lily Langtry. You'll have to pick it up yourself, madam. It's a shame, but he doesn't care for the flesh. He'll never see it.
Look at that girl over to his left. Look over to your left, bookworm.
Directed by Preston Sturges, this film tells the story of a con artist, played by Barbara Stanwyck, who sets her sights on a wealthy, naive, soon-to-be millionaire, aboard a luxury liner, only to find herself falling for him. That him is played by Henry Fonda.
What were you doing up the Amazon?
Looking for snakes. I'm an ophiologist.
I thought you were in the beer business.
Beer? Ale?
What's the difference?
Between beer and ale?
Yes.
Father'd burst a blood vessel if he heard you say that. There's a big difference. Ale's sort of fermented on the top or something, and beer's fermented on the bottom, or maybe it's the other way around. There's no similarity at all. See, the trouble with being descended from a brewer, no matter how long ago he brewed it, or whatever you call it, you're supposed to know all about something you don't give a hoot about. It's funny to be kneeling here at your feet talking about beer.
And what I love about this movie is the hilarious misunderstandings and role reversals as Stanwyck's character tries to keep her true identity a secret while hunting her prey.
We better get back now.
Yes, I guess so. You see, where I've been, I mean up the Amazon, you kind of forget how... I mean, when you haven't seen a girl in a long time.
Sturges does a great job directing as usual, and it doesn't hurt that I'm a Barbara Stanwyck fan either.
You weren't thinking of taking him, Harry.
Well, what were you thinking of?
I don't think you understand, either of you. This is on the up and up. I think I'm in love with the poor fish.
Coming in at number 9, His Girl Friday.
Starting to see that.
Where is he?
She jumped out the window.
I know that. Where is he?
Anyway,
I said.
She isn't dead.
Come to it, Hildy. Where have you got William?
He's in the desk. Huh? Kevin, she didn't kill herself.
How are you doing?
Let me out. I can't stand it.
Keep quiet. You're sitting pretty.
What's in there?
Who are you?
What are you doing?
Who is she?
This is Mrs. Baldwin, Bruce's mother.
What are you doing?
Shut up.
I won't shut up. You're doing something wrong.
Mother, please.
Take her out of here.
What? Wait a minute, Walter.
Quiet. Louis.
Yes, boy.
Take the lady over to Pollock Mike.
What? My name's Louis Peluso.
Lock her up. See if she doesn't talk to anyone.
You can't do this.
What'll I tell him?
Tell him it's a case of BT.
Don't worry, Mother. This is only temporary.
This fast-paced comedy, directed by Howard Hawks, revolves around a newspaper editor, played by Cary Grant, and a star reporter and ex-wife, played by Rosalind Russell, as they navigate love, journalism, and the pursuit of a big scoop.
Call the mayor. Get him over here right away.
Now, look here, madam. Be honest. If you were out joyriding, plastered, or got into some scrape, why don't you admit it instead of accusing innocent people?
Ruffian, how dare you talk like that to me?
They're just a little crazy, Mother.
And I can tell you something more.
Yes?
I can tell you why they did it.
Yeah.
They had some kind of a murderer in here, and they were hiding.
Oh, hiding it.
Yes. Yes.
In here.
Yes. Madam, yes. You're a cockeyed liar, and you know it.
What was that?
He's in there.
Give me the desk. Give me that phone. What a break.
Stand back, everybody.
Get my gun.
Get your guns out.
He's harmless.
Don't take any chances. Shoot right through the desk.
He can't hurt anybody. You've got his gun.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear.
Go on, you gray-haired old weasel.
Let me out.
Give me the desk.
Out.
Give me Jake.
Mother.
Close that door.
All over for you. What happened?
Hello, Jake. Hang on.
Everything called Duffy.
No, you don't.
You want to see a scoop?
In a minute.
Now, everybody.
Hold the wire.
Aim right at the center.
That's murder.
All right, Carl, Frank, one of you get on each end of the desk.
Something coming up.
We got you covered, Williams.
Have it in a minute.
Don't try to move.
Any time now.
I'll count three.
It's hot.
One.
Ready for an emergency.
Two.
Any second now.
Three, up with it. I got you, Williams.
Go ahead, shoot me.
Now, some might argue that this movie belongs higher on the list, and that's completely merited. What I love most about this film is the writing. The rapid-fire dialogue and witty banter between Grant and Russell showcase their undeniable chemistry and, of course, their acting abilities. Cary Grant has always been low-key funny in most of all of his movies. This movie was certainly a hit.
Attaboy, a man ought to be prepared for any emergency.
Well, Walter, I think we'd better be running along.
Yes, we'd better be going.
Where are we going?
I'm taking you two to lunch. Didn't you tell him, Hildy?
No, she didn't.
Well, I guess she just wanted to surprise you, Bruce. After you. After you, Hildy.
Wasting your time, Walter, won't be a bit of good.
No, I'm glad to do it. Glad to do it.
Next on my list at number 8, The Shop Around the Corner.
What have you become so interested in my idea of what's wrong?
Well, I want to please you, Mr. Kralik. After all, I'm working under you.
And you don't have to keep harping on that.
Oh, no, I didn't mean it that way at all, Mr. Kralik. Regardless of what I think of you personally, I believe that anybody who works with you and doesn't get a great deal out of it is just plain dumb.
Just what do you mean, what you think of me personally?
Oh, well, I mean, since you ask, no matter what anybody else says against you, I think you're a gentleman.
Well, try to be.
And, oh, Mr. Kralik, you have no idea what that means to a working girl. What a girl goes through in some shops. Now, take, for instance, when I was with Feldish Brothers and Sons. Well, the sons were all right, but the brothers, Mr. Kralik. And that's why I like it here so much. When you say, Miss Novak, let's go into the stockroom and put some bags on the shelf. Well, you really want to put some bags on the shelf. And that's my idea of a gentleman.
This is a sneaky good romantic comedy directed by Ernst Lubitsch. It's about two employees at a Budapest gift shop, played by James Stewart and Margaret Sullivan, who don't get along, but are falling in love through anonymous letters to each other, completely unaware that they are also each other's pen pals.
You know, for the last 6 months, you've done everything you could to antagonize me, and now you have nerve enough...
You haven't been very nice to me either. No matter what I do, it's wrong. If I wrap a package, that's not the right way. If I make a suggestion, and some of them are very good, you don't even listen. Everything has to be done just exactly your way, and then you don't like it. When I first came into the shop, I was full of life and enthusiasm. And now I'm nothing. You've taken my personality away. You're a dictator, that's what you are. Well, let me tell you, Mr. Kralik, any day now, I may be in a position where I don't have to work anymore. And then, Mr. Kralik, I'll really tell you what I think of you. And as for that blouse, I think it's beautiful, and I'm going to wear it tonight. Mr. Kralik, I don't like you.
Ernst Lubitsch is one of the most influential directors of his time, and he tells a funny story here.
As a matter of fact, there might be a lot we don't know about each other. You know, people seldom go to the trouble of scratching the surface of things to find the inner truth.
Well, I really wouldn't care to scratch your surface, Mr. Kralik, because I know exactly what I'd find. Instead of a heart, a handbag. Instead of a soul, a suitcase. And instead of an intellect, a cigarette lighter, which doesn't work.
Well, that's very nicely put.
My favorite scene in this movie is the revelation when Stewart's character discovers the true identity of his secret crush, Sullivan. Stewart's awkward style works perfectly against Sullivan's tough, witty style. I called it sneaky good because I discovered it one night and was completely in from scene one.
My, I didn't know you had a girlfriend.
Oh, yes, probably isn't easy for you to imagine anyone like a man of my type.
Now, Mr. Kralik, don't let's start all over again. It's Christmas and I'd like to be friends with you. Besides, you're wrong. Do you mind if I tell you something?
No, not at all.
Well, when I first came to work here, something very strange happened to me. I got psychologically mixed up.
You don't say?
Yes. I found myself looking at you again and again. I just couldn't take my eyes off you.
Oh?
Mm-hmm. And all the time I kept saying to myself, Clara Novak, what on earth is the matter with you? This Kralik is not a particularly attractive type of man. I hope you don't mind.
No.
Now, here comes a paradox. I found myself falling for you.
I can't believe it.
Yes, Mr. Kralik, and very much so.
You certainly didn't show it.
Listen, in those first few weeks, I know you won't misconstrue what I'm going to say to you. After all, I'm very happily engaged. At least it looks that way.
Yes, well, go on.
Oh, in those first few weeks, there were moments in the stockroom when you could have swept me off my feet.
Coming in at number 7 on my list, The Awful Truth.
Hello, Jerry.
Hello, Patsy, old girl. How are things?
We weren't expecting you.
Why, what goes on, huh? Mm-hmm.
Hiya, fella. Hello, Mr. Smith. How you been, huh? I'll see you in a minute, boy. Yeah, sure.
Hello, Jerry.
Hello, Lucy.
What might you be doing here?
Oh, now, don't tell me you've forgotten this is my day to visit Mr. Smith. It says so right there.
What? Oh, I'm so sorry, Mr. Leeson. This is my husband.
Oh,
he's only my husband for, how much longer is it now, 60 days?
59.
Ah, oh, that's better. Only 59 days. And don't worry about him. He has a continental mind.
Yes. Excuse me, what do you say?
I say I'm glad to know you.
How can you be glad to know me? I know how I'd feel if I was sitting with a girl and her husband walked in.
I'll bet you do.
You know, I don't think you ought to go around telling people you're not married. He looks like a nice sort of fella. How do you think he feels?
Why don't you go and play with the dog?
Why don't you go on with whatever you were doing? Don't mind me.
This is another screwball comedy featuring Cary Grant. It's directed by Leo McCary and also stars Irene Dunne. Jerry, Grant's character, is engaged to an heiress and is just waiting for the divorce to be finished. Lucy, Dunne's character, is a flighty, fun girl that doesn't realize how much she still loves Jerry.
Well, Lucy, the main idea is, do you accept my apology? Aside from making a blue ribbon sapper myself today, I must have embarrassed you beyond words. You took it fine, though.
Well, you must admit you were pretty funny.
Yes.
What
was that?
Nothing, just an old mirror. Oh, he's getting worse every day.
Well,
he's
Mr.
the biggest roughneck.
That's
neck.
A fine thing. I'm surprised that you were trying to get rid of me, huh?
No, he wasn't trying to get rid of you. You know it.
Well, I really hadn't planned to leave so soon, Lucy. You see, as a matter of fact, I thought if you had nothing to do, you might like to go for a drive with me. Well, the air would do you good, and we could talk things over, huh?
Oh, I'd love that.
They play a married couple who divorce because of some dubious misunderstandings and jealousy, only to realize in the end, they still love each other. The on-screen chemistry between Irene Dunne and Cary Grant was always great. They actually did 3 movies together and probably should have done more. Number 6 on my list, My Man Godfrey.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How'd you like to make $5?
I didn't quite catch what you said.
I said, how'd you like to make $5?
$5?
$5.
I don't want to seem inquisitive, but what would I have to do for it?
Oh, all you have to do is go to the Waldorf Ritz Hotel with me, and I'll show you to a few people, and then I'll send you right back.
May I inquire just why you would want to show me to people at the Waldorf Ritz?
Oh, if you must know, it's a game. You've probably heard about it, a scavenger hunt. If I find a forgotten man first, I win. Is that clear?
Yes, quite clear. Shall I wear my tails or come just as I am?
You needn't be fresh. Do you want the $5 or don't you?
Madam, I can't tell you how flattered I am by your very generous offer.
George!
However, I'm afraid I'll have to take it up with my board of directors.
Don't you touch me!
No matter what my board of directors advise, I think you should be spanked.
George, do something!
You in the habit of hitting ladies?
Maybe. I'm in the habit of hitting gentlemen also, if that'll interest you.
Well, aren't you going to do anything?
Yes, let's get a policeman.
In this classic comedy, a scatterbrained Harris, Irene, played by Carol Lombard, hires a homeless dude, Godfrey, played by William Powell, as her ridiculously out-of-touch family's butler, without knowing about his true identity and his past. Her sister, Cornelia, hates this idea and spends most of the movie trying to get Godfrey fired.
I think I'd better.
My word! There's Cornelia, and she has another one!
You're a little late, Cornelia. I've won the game.
Oh, you have.
Now, where do I get my $5?
Box? Will you talk to your sister? She wants to hire this man as a butler.
Why not? He might make a very good butler.
I'm sure I'd make a very good butler.
Hey, where do I get my $5?
As Irene starts falling for her new butler, Godfrey turns the tables and teaches her frivolous family a lesson or two.
What is your address?
City Dump 32, East River, Sutton Place.
It's rather fashionable over there, isn't it?
In spots.
Is that your permanent address?
Well, the permanency is rather questionable. See, the place is being rapidly filled in.
Do you mind if I ask you a personal question?
If it isn't too personal.
Are those whiskers your own?
No one else has claimed them.
I must ask that question because one group tried to fool the committee the early part of the evening by putting false whiskers on one of their own group. May
what?
I...
Oh, it's a pleasure.
One more question. Are you wanted by the police?
Oh, that's just the trouble. Nobody wants me.
A very good answer.
Splendid, Godfrey. You mean nobody wants him? Nobody at all?
Nobody.
Oh, that's too bad.
Oh, on the contrary, I sometimes find it a great advantage.
The committee, you're satisfied.
My favorite scene in this movie is when Godfrey makes fools of Irene's family and guests at the end of the Forgotten Man's scavenger hunt. The realization of love between Lombard and Powell's characters amidst the chaotic dynamics of a wealthy family and considering the lingering effects of the Great Depression adds to the social commentary. Not only that, during the filming of this movie, Lombard and Powell were actually married. It's a great flick.
If you don't want to, but I'd make a wonderful wife.
Well, not for me, I'm afraid. See, I like you very much. I had a very bitter experience. But I won't bore you with that.
Well, maybe she wasn't in love with you.
Well, maybe not. However, that's beside the point. You and I are friends. And I feel a certain responsibility to you. That's why I wanted to tell you first.
Tell me what?
Well, I thought it was about time that I was moving on.
God.
Now, please.
I won't cry, I promise.
Well, that's fine. After all, I'm your protege. You want me to improve myself, don't you?
Yes.
You don't want me to go on being just a butler all my life, do you?
I want you to be anything you want to be.
Well, now that's very sweet.
Coming in at number 5 on my top 10 classic romantic comedies, Annie Hall.
Go to that one, there.
You know, maybe we should just call the police. Dial 911. It's the Lobster Squad.
Come on, Algie. They're only baby ones, for God's sake.
If they're only babies, then you pick them up.
Oh, all right, all right, all right. Here you go. Oh,
don't give it to me. Don't. Look, one crawl behind the refrigerator. It'll turn up in our bed at night. Will you get out of here with that thing?
I'm sorry.
Jesus.
Get it.
Talk to him. You speak shellfish.
This is a Woody Allen film, and perhaps his crowning achievement, in my opinion. He plays Avi Singer, a 40-year-old, twice-divorced, neurotic, intellectual, Jewish, New York City stand-up comic who reflects on the ending of his latest relationship to Annie Hall, played by Diane Keaton, an insecure, flighty, Midwestern wasp who's aspiring to be a nightclub singer.
A first aid kit and a fire extinguisher.
All right, give me a magazine, because I'm a little tired. You know, you joke with them about me, you make fun of me, but I'm prepared for anything, an emergency, a tidal wave, an earthquake. Hey, what is this? What, did you go to a rock concert?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, really? Really? How'd you like it? Was it heavy? Did it achieve total heaviosity, or was it?
It was just great.
I got a wonderful idea. Why don't you get the guy that took you to the rock concert? We'll call him, and he can come over and kill the spider. You know,
I called you. You want to help me or not, huh?
What is this? Since when do you read the National Review? What are you turning into?
Well, I like to try to get all points of view.
Well, wonderful. Then why don't you get William F. Buckley to kill the spider?
Alvie, you're a little hostile. You know that?
My favorite scene is definitely the movie theater line. Alvie and Annie's banter and wit are on full display even in very public situations, which lends to Woody Allen's style of directing and his comedic timing. And let's not forget the writing. It's as sharp as it is funny.
I admire the technique, but it doesn't hit me on a gut level.
I'd like to hit this guy on a gut level.
Stop it, Alvie.
He's spitting on my neck. You know, he's spitting on my neck.
The most important thing of all,
and you know something else? You know, you're so egocentric that if I miss my therapy, you can only think of it in terms of how it affects you.
It's well done, Sean, is what it is.
Probably on their first date, right?
It's a worldview that...
Probably met by answering an ad in the New York Review of Books. 30-ish academic wishes to meet woman who's interested in Mozart, James Joyce, and sodomy. What do you mean our sexual problem? Okay. I mean, I'm comparatively normal for a guy raised in Brooklyn.
Okay, I'm very sorry. My sexual problem. Okay, my sexual problem, huh?
I never read that. That was Henry James, right? Novel?
You know
the sequel to Turn of the Screw?
Number 4 on the list, Adam's Rib.
Woman shot her husband.
Kill him?
Wait a second. I think she, let's see. Nope.
That's a shame.
Condition critical, though.
Congratulations.
Wow.
What?
Wait a second.
What is it?
Oh, find it in yours.
It isn't in here.
He was playing her fast and loose, so she caught him out and popped him a few .32 calibers.
Who?
This lady I've been telling you
some
about.
Some lady.
Serves him right, the little two-timer.
Katharine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy are back together for this classic side-splitting romantic comedy as married lawyers Amanda and Adam, who find themselves on the opposite sides of a murder case. This movie is directed by George Cukor. Adam and Amanda are both determined to win the case, and their home becomes the setting for comical showdowns with neither one of them willing to back off.
All right, break it up.
Adam, listen to me, Adam.
Don't you handle me, lady. I'm not nutty. Not any more than the average. You said it yourself today, didn't you? You said anyone is capable of attack if provoked. You bet, including me. Yes. Don't you move, young man. You stand as still as you can be.
Now, Adam. Adam.
You said that before.
Now, Adam, you're sick. Please. What do you think you're doing?
Teaching a lesson. Him first, then comes yours. Now, get away, Amanda.
Adam, stop.
Get away, Amanda.
Don't you do it, Amanda.
Stop it, Adam. Stop it. You've no right. You can't do what you're doing. You've no right.
What?
No one has a right to...
That's all, sister. That's all I wanted to hear. Music to my tin ear.
My favorite scene is no doubt the courtroom showdown between Tracy and Hepburn's characters, highlighting their professional rivalry and personal dynamics. These two were legendary on and off the screen, reflecting their real-life decades-long romance. Needless to say, their chemistry was always apparent on the silver screen, and it's not different here. Coming in at number three on my list, It Happened One Night.
I think I'll write that book after all.
Yeah, think of all the fun you had, though.
Do you mind if I try?
You? Don't make me laugh.
Oh, you're such a smart aleck. Nobody knows anything but you. I'll stop a car, and I won't use my thumb.
What are you going to do?
It's a system all my own.
Directed by Frank Capra, this iconic film follows the unlikely romance between a brash newspaper reporter played by Clark Gable and a runaway heiress played by Claudette Colbert as they embark on a cross-country adventure. The laughs start almost immediately, and considering the year it was produced, this is almost as raunchy as a comedy got back then.
Next month, they want us to come. Oh, yeah, she saw your sister on the street the other day. Says she's looking swell.
Come in.
You know, I hope Aunt Bella has a boy, don't you? Grandma says it's going to be a girl, though, and she hasn't missed calling one in years.
May I here to see your sweetheart?
Who, me? You want to see me?
What's your name?
Are you addressing me?
Yeah, what's your name?
Hey, wait a minute. That's my wife you're talking to. What do you mean, come here? What do you want, anyway?
We're looking for somebody.
Yeah, well, look your head off, but don't come busting in here. This isn't a public park. I got nerves to take a sock at you.
Take it easy, son. Take it easy.
These men are detectives, Mr. Moore.
I don't care if they're the whole police department. They can't come busting in here shooting questions at my wife.
Now, don't get so excited, Peter. The men just ask you a civil question.
Oh, is that so? Say, how many times have I told you to stop butting in when I'm having an argument?
Well, you don't have to lose your temper.
My favorite scene is probably the most remembered scene in this movie. The famous Walls of Jericho scene, where Gable's character teaches Colbert's character the art of undressing behind a makeshift curtain. Gable and Colbert were great together, leading to some very funny and sensuous situations in this movie.
Well, I like privacy when I retire. Yes, I'm very delicate in that respect. Prying eyes annoy me. Behold the walls of Jericho. Maybe not as thick as the ones that Joshua blew down with his trumpet, but a lot safer. You see, I have no trumpet. Now, just to show you my heart's in the right place, I'll give you my best pair of pajamas. Do you mind joining the Israelites? You don't want to join the Israelites? All right. Perhaps you're interested in how a man undresses. You know, there's a funny thing about that. Quite a study in psychology. No two men do it alike. You know, I once knew a man who kept his hat on until he was completely undressed. Yeah, now he made a picture. Years later, his secret came out. He wore a toupee. Yeah. You know, I have a method all my own. If you'll notice, the coat came first, then the tie, then the shirt. Now, according to Hoyle, after that, the pants should be next. There's where I'm different. I go for the shoes next. First the right, then the left. After that, it's every man for himself.
Coming in at number two on my list, The Apartment.
Good morning, Miss Livingston. Good morning, Mr. Kelly. Good morning, Mr. Schubert. Good morning, Mr. Davis. Good morning, Mr. Kirk. 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 Good morning, Mr. Davis. Yorker between the ages of 20 and 50 has 2.5 calls a year.
Now, that makes me feel just terrible.
Why?
Well, to make the figures come out even, if I have no colds a year, some poor slob must have 5 colds a year.
Yeah, it's me.
Should have stayed in bed this morning.
I should have stayed in bed last night.
I featured this movie in the spotlight I did on director Billy Wilder a few weeks ago. This is a great movie. Jack Lemmon stars as a mild-mannered insurance clerk who lends his apartment to his philandering bosses for their extramarital affairs, only to fall for an elevator operative played by Shirley MacLaine, who's involved with one of those execs romantically.
One of the guys in our department lives in Jersey. Had to go to a banquet at the Biltmore. His wife was beating him in town. He needed some place to change into a tuxedo, so I gave him the key. And word must have gotten out, because the next thing I knew, all sorts of guys are suddenly going to banquets. Well, you give the key to one guy, you can't say no to another. The whole thing got out of hand. Pardon me.
Baxter, an insurance company is founded on public trust. Any employee who conducts himself in a manner unbecoming... How many charter members are there in this little club?
Well, hell, just those 4. Out of a total of 31,259. So actually, we could be very proud of our personnel, percentage-wise.
That's not the point, Baxter. Oh. 4 rotten apples in a barrel, no matter how large the barrel. You realize if this ever leaked out...
It won't!
My favorite scene is the last one. As you would probably think, all romantic comedy should end with the last scene being the best. The guy gets the girl, or rather the girl gets the guy in this case. Either way, the writing, directing, and acting are top-notch. It was actually hard to keep this out of my number one spot.
Sure? How's your knee?
I'm fine all over.
Mind if I come in?
Of course not.
At this point, I'd like to throw in a couple honorable mentions. The first one, the Philadelphia Story.
He's no great tower of strength, you know, Tracy. He's just a tower.
You hardly know him.
Well, I hardly know him as to know him well. And perhaps it offends my vanity to have anyone who was even remotely my wife remarry so obviously beneath her.
How dare you, any of you, in this day and age, use such an idiotic...
I'm talking about the difference in mind and spirit. You could marry Mac, the night watchman. I'd cheer for you. Kittredge is not for you.
You bet he's for me. He's a great man and a good man. Already, he's of national importance.
You sound like Spy Magazine talking.
This is one of the greatest romantic comedies ever produced, to be honest. And low-key, if not for the fact that all three main characters have a movie on this list, it would have been on this list for sure. My second honorable mention, Claudine. Diane Carroll was nominated for Best Actress in her role as Claudine, a single black mother in New York City who endures an exhausting commute to the suburbs 5 days a week, where she works as a maid for wealthy white families. She meets Rupert, played by James Earl Jones, a charismatic but irresponsible garbage man. They develop a romance, but Claudine doubts that their relationship is good for her six children. This is a warm, romantic, and funny movie that definitely deserves a place on anyone's romantic comedy list.
Suppose I do not marry this lady. Now, if I move in with her and do not tell you, then we're both crooks, right? But if I do tell you, then we're back to the income and the outcome and the deducting, and you drive me to drink. And you call a fraud if I spend $7 for a bottle of whiskey.
And now, my number one favorite romantic comedy, Roman Holiday. This movie probably doesn't need much of an introduction. It's directed by William Wyler. Audrey Hepburn and Gregory Peck star in this internationally adored tale about a princess named Anne, played by Hepburn, who happens to meet an American journalist, Joe Bradley, played by Peck. Bradley, recognizing a hot news story, pretends that he doesn't recognize her and offers to give her a guided tour of Rome, hoping to get an exclusive interview. And actually, Joe falls in love with her. I mean, it's Audrey Hepburn. My favorite scene is when Princess Anne is tipsy and goes back to Bradley's place. When she wakes up the next morning, not only is she still at his place, but in his pajamas.
Thank you. Are these yours?
Did you lose something?
No. Would you be so kind as to tell me where I am?
Well, this is what is laughingly known as my apartment.
Did you bring me here by force?
No. Quite the contrary.
Have I been here all night alone?
If you don't count me, yes.
So I've spent the night here with you.
Oh, well, now, I don't know that I'd use those words exactly. But, from a certain angle, yes.
I'm a Hepburn fan, as you might already know. I did a spotlight on her a couple weeks ago. In this film, Hepburn's style and inevitable charm matches the stoic Mr. Peck and makes for perhaps the greatest romantic comedy ever produced. And there you have it, folks. My top 10 romantic comedies that I grew up loving and continue to warm my heart to this day. Whether it's the madcap antics of His Girl Friday or the bittersweet romance of Roman Holiday, these films remind us of the enduring magic of love, light, and laughter. Until next time, keep watching and falling in love with the classics. Now, if you enjoyed the segment and want to see more classic Hollywood features that I produce, like and subscribe to my channel and turn your friends on to it. I'll be glad you did, and they might be too. And remember,
I'll be back.